So, my people, another book, Influencer. Freaking love this book. And it's the same people that wrote Crucial Conversations and Crucial Confrontations. Freaking awesome. So it's five people that have all kind of collaborated on these books, and they're brilliant. They're very much into, communication, company culture, like interaction, eliminating conflict and creating good, like group cohesiveness in within businesses and things. So very cool. They're creative and good writers. They use a lot of stories to kind of tell their story, tell the, make their points, which is obviously more fun to read. And they pick a few in this book that kind of last for the entire book. So they kind of bounce back and forth between different stories to kind of prove their point, and show where these different influence strategies work. So if you are a business leader or, a manager or own a business, or just, I mean, even if you're not, this is fabulous just for your family. So I'll share a few of the points that they make in here, but I just want to kind of like a couple of the topics they use. One of them is Dr. Mimi Silbert, who's like this incredible woman who takes these hardened criminals, like people with like four felony charges, right? They keep going back out into public, promising they're going to change, and then they can't change, and they go back to prison, and it's just over and over, same problems until they get into her program at DLNC. And then she applies every single strategy in this book to help these people change their lives, and they'll basically that she helps them have like social accountability. They're accountable for someone else. They have a mentor who's going to show them. They incrementally get promotions throughout the program. So they start with maybe setting the forks at the dinner table. That's their role. And if they once they master that, they move on to another one. And then it's step by step. They go from a dorm of like nine people in their little dorm or cell, more like, to one with five, with three, with one, then they get an apartment outside of, the jail basically, and eventually they're working normal jobs within society, living at a normal apartment, and what, and they're, good citizens of society because of this delinquency program. She has influenced 14,000 criminals, helped them become, decent citizens in the communities, which if that's not influence, then holy crap, man! Like 14,000 criminals, like, and not just people with a, that got in a fight in public. This is people that, drug dealers and drug cartels and Crips and Bloods and like just like gangsters of every kind, and she helps them make connections. So it's crazy. And another one of the stories is dealing with like a parasite in a river, in a third world country. There's weight loss tactics, things like that. So it's very, very interesting. Let me just share with you a couple of points that like I thought, so it turns out that all influence geniuses focus on behaviors. They're inflexible on this point. I'll get to another one that's on the same topic, but basically, you don't reward outcome, you reward behavior. And some people, like, you even reward those incremental behavioral changes, right? So if somebody's like decent at their job, but they're not doing a great job, you help them modify their behavior and then reward that throughout the process, and eventually they'll get to where you want them to be. So a lot of managers think like you only reward really extraordinary things, but most people don't achieve extraordinary things. So then they never get rewarded. They never get that positive reinforcement. They never, hit one goal and then strive for the next. They just kind of stay stagnant. So reward positive behavior and only behavior, not outcome. Several times, companies have been outwitted by their employees because of an incentive program to achieve some number or goal, and the employees are smarter than you think. They'll They'll find a way to manipulate that, slack one day, go nuts the next, or change the, like the example in here, the size of the nails, like instead of cranking out this certain size of nail, they'll just crank out a million small ones. Or if you go by weight, they'll just crank out a bunch of big ones. Like, it's just they're smart like that. So, one vital behavior consists of the use of praise versus the use of punishment. Top performers reward positive performance far more frequently than their counterparts. Bottom performers quickly become discouraged and mutter things such as, didn't I just teach you that 2 minutes ago? The best consistently reinforce even moderate good performance. There's a section in the book that talks about like a lot of people think that like punishment will keep them from doing things wrong or make them do it right, but punishment comes with a whole bunch of like side effects that you don't want in your business. It basically creates a culture of its own, but you don't know which one you're going to get until it's kind of too late. And so punishment's a last resort. People do not respond well to punishment. They might get a short-term effect, desired effect, but it's not a long-term gain. Talks about weight loss strategies and that the people who statistically were able to lose 30 pounds and keep it off do three things, three vital behaviors. They exercise on equipment at home, they eat breakfast, and they weigh themselves daily. Just keep it simple, right? Those three things. In the end of the book, he talks about like the proximity of things, literal physical distance. So in a business, if the upper management is not like close to the rest of the employees, it becomes like the enemy. When they're like very close, they feel like a team member and they get to know each other and things. And so, even in like weight loss, if your exercise equipment is in your living room by your TV, you'll use it, a fair amount. If you even move it out to your garage, you decrease like dramatically. And if you go to a gym down the street a ways, it decreases even farther. So it's just interesting that little teeny things, like a matter of a few feet, change people's behavior in a big way. So people choose their behaviors based on what they think will happen to them as a result. It's interesting how ingrained we are with our own thoughts. So people will they'll tell themselves a false story as long as they can predict the results. So if they think something great is going to happen, then they'll strive for something, right? But most of the time they don't think some extraordinary thing is going to happen because it doesn't. Like we don't pick up things and reward them or throw these extra perks in for taking a step. And so people just kind of go through the monotony of the day without trying to become excellent. The greater persuader is personal experience. So if they've experienced some good positive feedback before and it happens over and over, then that becomes the culture is I'm going to try to do my best, and I ex you know and the expectation is that my peers, my management, everyone's going to notice. We're all going to have this nice little kumbaya. But it's legit. Like you're continually growing and growing and growing and getting better. It should be that way. Here's their little map of influence. Those are six ways. Those are the six strategies of influence, and that's all you need. If you can create these six things, you can change anything basically. And the examples they use in this book are big enough to prove that you can change anything. Like the criminals that I talked about, 14,000. It's nuts. They also an AIDS problem in I think it's Thailand, like years ago they were on track to having basically like half the population have AIDS until somebody stepped in and found a way to change that. But just think of having to change a certain behavior in like almost half of the population of an entire country. That's crazy, but they did it. Let me see. As a part of this focus on specific levels of achievement, top performers set their goals to improve behaviors or processes rather than outcomes. For instance, top volleyball performers set process goals aimed at the set, the dig, the block, and so on. Mediocre performers set outcome goals such as winning so many points or garnering applause. So in basketball, better shooters set technical-oriented goals such as keep the elbow in or follow through. Players who shoot 55% and under tend to think more about result-oriented goals such as this time I'm going to make 10 in a row. He also talks about how those that section, the ones that shoot less than 55% from the free throw, when they miss, they'll tell you something like, I didn't focus, or I wasn't, I wasn't into it, or some very broad, general, subjective thing. Whereas the good shooters, the ones that shoot over 70% from the free throw line, when they miss a shot, they can tell you why they missed it. I didn't use my legs. I let my elbow drift. I didn't follow through enough. They mechanically know exactly what went wrong, versus the ones who are poor shooters just are like, well, I lost my focus. So anyway, I won't read any more of the book, but very good book. I highly recommend this. I've read it a few times, and I keep coming back to it because I feel like it has some serious value as far as my own businesses and things. How can I influence employees, especially from, so some of you know, I run a business that is almost completely online and through telephone and everything. So I'm not, like, one big problem is I'm not close to my employees. In fact, my employees are all over the place. So how do I stay present and engaged? Like, I have to consciously, like, make a phone call to people and just engage them. Like, it's not necessarily, like, usually there's some business involved with it, but a lot of times it's just like, see how they're doing, see what's going on, allow them a chance to talk and vent and whatever. And I try to maintain like a more of like a friendship type relationship with some of them, because first of all, I don't need to motivate them to work because they're amazing workers, but I do want to keep them loyal. I do want to keep them happy. I want to stay like close, right? I don't want to be that big bad enemy. I want to be a partner and a piece of the team, and that's how I truly see it. So it's interesting, I gotta find new ways to connect and apply these principles. But the influencer, the power to change anything, seriously, it's one of my favorite books as far as like a business development book. So anyway, go out and buy it. I'll put a link here on so you can purchase from Amazon. And anyway, we'll talk to you guys later. Thanks.